Let's study the molecular structure of triglycerides. Triglycerides. And in everyday language, we often call these fats. We often call these fats, which is often kind of a feared word, but as we'll see, it's essential for life. Fats, and in liquid form, it's sometimes referred to as oils. And a more technical term for triglycerides, triglyceride is the word that you might hear when you go to the doctor's office, but it can also be referred to as and I'm gonna do the different parts in different colors, triacylglycerol. I actually like this second name more because it makes sense when you break down the molecule. Triacylglycerol. But triglycerides, this is literally fat, or what most people typically refer to as fat. They're talking about triglycerides. If you were to get your cholesterol checked, or if your parents get their cholesterol checked, they'll probably get a report on triglycerides, which is really a measure of the fat concentration in their blood. But let's think about what a triglyceride is. And so here I have the constituent molecules of a triglyceride. This molecule on the left, this is glycerol. Let me do it in that same blue that I just wrote glycerol in. This is glycerol. We can see we have a 3-carbon chain right over here. Each of those carbons is attached to a hydroxyl group, an OH group. If you just get attached to one of them, this makes you an alcohol, so this definitely makes it an alcohol. This is sometimes called a triol. It has 3 hydroxyl groups right over here. And this is considered to be a sugar alcohol, We see why it's an alcohol. It's got its hydroxyl groups, and it's also sweet. If you were to drink a solution of glycerol, it will actually be sweet. And you might already be familiar with the word glycerol from the famous Bush song, Glycerine. Glycerine is referring to glycerol. Glycerine. So there you go. That is a glycerol right over there. And you form a triglyceride when a glycerol molecule reacts with 3 fatty acid molecules. So these characters on the right, these are each a fatty acid. This is one fatty acid, this is another fatty acid, this is another fatty acid. Now why do we call them fatty, and in particular, why do we call them a fatty acid? Well, you have one part that has these big carbon chains here, and I drew these dot, dot, dots because they can actually have different numbers of carbons. They can have anywhere between, based on my research, you can have into the high 20s numbers of carbons. In most biological systems, you tend to have an even number of carbons, and in most animal biology, you tend to have 16 to 20 carbons. And if it's an even number, you're talking about 16, 18, 20 carbons involved in these fatty acids. All of the ones I've drawn have all single bonds, so the carbons are, we have as many hydrogens bonded to it as possible, but you could also have double bonds there, and we'll talk about that more when we talk about saturated and unsaturated fats. So you have this carbon chain here, and that part is hydrophobic. It won't dissolve well in water, and that's why people tend to refer to it as kind of fatty. And then you have on the left hand, or at least the way I've drawn on the left hand side, you have a carboxyl group. So this right over here, this is a carboxyl group, and this is acidic. It's very easy for it to donate a hydrogen, because if it donates a hydrogen, or a hydrogen proton, I should say, because if this oxygen takes those electrons, that negative charge can be spread between this oxygen and this oxygen over here. And so it's very willing to give away a hydrogen, so that makes it acidic. So that's where the acid comes from. That's a fatty acid. And when you have these 3 molecules, they don't have to be identical. This one could have 18 carbons. This one over here could have 16 carbons. This one could have 20 carbons. It might have a couple of double bonds in it. So they could all be different. But let's think about how they actually form together, like, you know, those robot movies from the 80s, like Voltron. So what you have happening, and this is going to be a little bit of organic chemistry, and this is really just a review of dehydration synthesis. You have a lone pair in each of these oxygens that are part of the hydroxyl group. So let me draw that. So you have a lone pair there, or yes, you have 2 lone pairs. You have 2 lone pairs over there. You have 2 lone pairs over there. And so you can imagine a world where if they just bump past each other in just the right way, this carbon over here is going to have a partially positive charge. It has three bonds to two oxygens, oxygens that are very electronegative. And so this guy, if he just bumps into it in the right way, these electrons could be used to form a bond with this carbon, the one that has that partially positive charge. And just as that is happening, this bond could be let go. This oxygen say, okay, look, you're sharing in another pair. I've had enough of that. I'm going to take these electrons for myself, or even better, I'm going to take them for myself and eventually capture, or maybe I capture first, it can happen in all different ways, a hydrogen proton. I'm gonna capture a hydrogen proton, and then I can become this collection right over here could become a water molecule. And I'm doing just a very high level overview of the mechanism. You can go into more depth of this when you go into organic chemistry, but this could happen three times. So it could happen again over here. Could happen again over here. This guy takes, let me do that in that same white color. So he takes both of these electrons that he so badly wants to take back and maybe uses it to grab a hydrogen proton. It could happen the other way. Maybe grabs a hydrogen proton and then just as he's leaving, this guy comes back. So there's different ways that all of these can happen, but this is the general idea. And then you have it happening a third time down here. One of these lone pairs come and form a bond with this carbon in the carbonyl group, part of this carboxyl group. And so once again, this guy can take those two electrons away and maybe share that pair with a hydrogen proton. Once again, this is forming a water molecule. This is forming a water molecule. So three water molecules are going to be produced. This is why we call it dehydration synthesis. We're losing three water molecules in order to form these bonds. So what's it going to look like after this has happened? Well, let me scroll down here. Let me just scroll down here. So this green bond over here is going to now, so this green bond that's this big long curvy thing is this green bond. And this second green bond is this green bond. And this third green bond is that green bond. And each of these, the way I've drawn it right now, each of these oxygens haven't let go of its hydrogens. And that could actually happen before or after or all at the same time. Chemistry actually is not a clean thing. But I could, if I want, I could draw the hydrogens here. I could draw the hydrogens over here, and then these would have a positive charge. These would have a positive charge, but then you can imagine another water molecule coming by and snapping, kind of taking one of these hydrogen protons, taking the hydrogen protons away from each of those oxygens, and then you would be left with this molecule right over here. And remember, we produced three water molecules. So that's one, two, and three water molecules. And now this molecule, if you ignore the water molecules out there, this is a triglyceride. Let me write them a little slightly more technical term, sometimes referred to as triacylglycerol. Well, we know where the glycerol comes from. It has this glycerol backbone right over here. Now, what does acyl mean? Well, acyl is a functional group where you have a carbon that's in a carbonyl, that's part of a carbonyl group. It can be bound to a kind of an organic chain right over here. I'll just call that R, and then it's bound to something else. And so we have three acyl groups. So triacyl. So this right over here. This right here is an acyl group. This right over here is an acyl group. This right over here is an acyl group. Each of them, they're bound to an oxygen. They're bound to an oxygen right over here. And actually, that gives us more practice with another functional group. When you have a situation, let me get another color out. When you have a carbon that is, or you have a carbonyl group, and let's say you have just an organic chain right over here, and then you have an oxygen, and then you have another organic chain right over there, this thing is called an ester. This thing is called an ester. And you actually see three esters right over here. So this, you see this ester right over here, you see this ester right over here, and then this ester right over here. So this wasn't just practice in learning about fats or triacylglycerol or triglycerides. These are all words for the same thing. It's giving us good practice with these functional groups. But now you see where triacylglycerol comes from. You have glycerol backbone, and you have these three acyl groups that allow it to attach to the fatty acids. So that's what fat is when people are referring to it. And this is just pictures of it. This is coconut oil right over here. It's right here. It's below its melting point, so it's in its solid form. And this right over here, I'm not sure which type of oil this is, but it's past its melting point, and so it's in its liquid form, so people would typically refer to this as an oil. But this is made up of a bunch of triglycerides. This is a big mixture of triglycerides here. And if you were to see their molecules, they would all have generally this shape, but the fatty acids would have different numbers of carbons and might have different numbers of double bonds.